Welcome everyone to the Apple Live stream. We're here today in Helen Mayo Park, Park 27. We're here to protest Stephen Marshall's $660 million 15,000 seat stadium, which will require removing so many hundreds of trees. Some of these trees are over a century old and will obliterate most of this park from the Adelaide Park Lands. So that's what we're doing here today. We're going to see some people speaking, and at the moment we've got a bit of music. So just while we get everyone online and watching the stream, I'll go for a bit of a wander and just show you what's going on and how many people we have here, etc. So speeches should be kicking off at about 3 to 5 minutes. We have lots of people searching for shade because, well, Channel 7's here, because it is quite a beautiful day here in the Adelaide Parklands. Hello to the two people watching at the moment. Much appreciated.
That you will know, this one,
Here we are under the shade of this tree, one of the trees that will undoubtedly be destroyed, that's been giving shade for many, many decades. Let's keep wandering.
Sorry.
No, no, you're right. Shouldn't be long now before we start hearing from our speakers. A bit more of a media presence here now too, which is good to see. Quite a wide-angle lens, so that's better. All right, we're about to get underway. Thanks to the people watching at home.
Good afternoon. My name's Anne Moran. I'm a area councillor with the Adelaide City Council, and I'd like you to put your hands together for the Serotonins for their wonderful performance. They're telling us with very apt songs, played in the parking lot, is exactly what they're doing. I'd also like to recognise that we're meeting on Kaurna land and recognise elders past and present. Just running through a bit of housekeeping. This is a COVID-safe event. You need to check in using your QR codes. If you haven't done so, there are check-in sheets taped on the van. There are two other QR code sheets in the picnic table and here in the marquee, along with a paper sheet for manual sign-in if you don't have a smartphone. If you have not registered through Everbright for this event, then I'm sorry, but you need to leave the area. There are heavy penalties for breaching COVID restrictions. This is defined as a private event, which means we're allowed only 150 people. I think you could probably overrule that. I think we probably haven't reached the 150. You also need to practice social distancing, which means distance of 1.5 metres. Coffee and crepes are available for you in the crepe van, and there is free coffee for you if you ordered it when registering for your attendance. If you didn't book it, then you can still get coffee, but you need to pay at the van. The free coffee doesn't include any free crepes, although the van is well set up to cater for you with crepes. There are two plastic bins provided, one marked for landfill waste and the other for recycling. Please use them and don't litter the park. In the risk management plan for this event, the dirt slope has been identified as a potential hazard. And therefore I am obliged to advise you to stay within the grassy area for your own safety and the safety of the children present. Right. I'd like to introduce speaker one, Shane Sodi. Shane is the president of the Adelaide Park Lands Association. Shane's working career involved four separate phases spread over more than four decades. Firstly, as a well-known radio news presenter. Second, as a political media advisor and researcher. Thirdly, as a lawyer working in public service. And fourthly, as a local government policy advisor and administrator. Now retired from paid employment, Shane has been leading the Parklands Association into a new era, with revamped branding and a strategic plan to capture the imagination of most South Australians with just four words: love your parklands. So could you put your hands together for Shane Sodi?
Thank you very much, Anne. Welcome to the world's only park with a city inside it. How cool is that? Let me share with you two of my favourite quotes. You've probably heard them before. They're well worn, but they're appropriate today. First, from Margaret Mead. Never doubt that a small group of thoughtful people can change the world. It's the only thing that ever has. Thank you for being here and being part of this small group of thoughtful people. An even better quote from Benjamin Disraeli: history is made by those who show up. You've shown up, you're going to make history. Take a look around, smile and nod to the person next to you. You're making history. Give yourselves a round of applause. You deserve it because you're here. That point's worth labouring, because as we engage to protect your parklands from the wannabe developers, there are some people who are noticeable by their absence. About 2 years ago, we had a fight to save Denise Norton Park, the site of the Aquatic Centre. The Adelaide Crows wanted that park to build their massive corporate headquarters with a tiny swimming pool attached. We staged a public event like this one and invited the Crows management to speak. They did not turn up. They snubbed more than 250 people at our public meeting. Eventually, they gave up the fight. In that fight, history was won by those who showed up. Today, the state government wants to take up to 70 hectares of your parklands away from you. They've earmarked this site for a $660 million, 15,000-seat stadium, but they've got much worse and larger ambitions than that. Every single member of the state government is too busy to be here today. The Premier's office told me, quote, due to regional travel commitments, the Premier is unable to attend and sends his apologies. Regrettably, I have been unable to secure a representative to attend on the Premier's behalf. There are 31 Liberals in State Parliament. Admittedly, their numbers have been declining in recent weeks due to defections. But of those 31 who remain, none of them are available to try to justify to you today the biggest attack on the Adelaide Park Lands in the 184-year history of it. Not one. History is made by those who turn up. The Lord Mayor, Sandy Verschoor, was invited here today as well. The Lord Mayor's assistant advised me, quote, "We were unsuccessful in being able to manipulate the Lord Mayor's commitments to facilitate her attendance on this occasion. Please accept the Lord Mayor's sincere apologies that she is unable to attend." I wrote back and asked whether the Lord Mayor could nominate another councillor to represent her, and I was told, quote, "As there is not yet a council decision and an official council position on this matter, the Lord Mayor is unable to nominate a councillor to represent her or the City of Adelaide." Now, there has actually been a council decision about the state government's recently proposed attacks on parklands. I believe Councillor Phillip Martin, who is speaking next, are you here, Phillip? Because I haven't seen you. Yes, he is, good. He'll put the record straight on that, I believe. But I'm not here to score points against individual people. I'm here because I love the Adelaide Parklands. I want to see your Adelaide Parklands remain as open, green, public, or get restored, perhaps, as open, green, public. Now, there are two or three ways of getting to this spot, and I know a lot of people had trouble finding it because it's not well known. I'd just like to check how you got here. Hands up those who walked or drove in from Montefiore Road, from the bridge. Yeah, that's probably most of you. And who walked up the stairs behind or beside either of the rowing clubs? A smaller number, okay. That smaller number, you would have had a much better view of Helen Mayo Park getting here. You think you can see some trees around you, but you can't see all of them. You can't even see a fraction of the trees in Helen Mayo Park. There's a lot more down closer to the river, in front of the rowing clubs, Riverside. If you walked up by the stairs, you would have seen a massive pair of blue gums right by the river and the she oaks, river she oaks right by the stairs. This park is named in honour of a great South Australian, and I believe we have her great niece here tonight, today. A woman who grew up in the late 1800s and wanted to be a doctor, even though she had never even heard of the possibility of a woman being a doctor. What would Helen Mayo think about a park named in her honour suddenly being discarded and consigned to the dustbin of history? Because that's what's at stake. Helen Mayo Park is a triangle of land in between the river and the railway line. From the Morford Street Bridge, where many of you came in, the pedestrian or cycling path goes along the riverfront down to a pedestrian tunnel under the railway line, almost a kilometre away. If you haven't done it before, try after this event or sometime soon walking along that river path. Once you get past the weir, the path splits in two. You've got an upper bitumen path and a lower dirt path. Take the dirt path lower because, for one thing, you're much less likely to get run over by a cyclist. And for another thing, you get a much better view of vegetation right along the river. You could be in a park. Open, green, and public. Take in that environment, because that, and appreciate it while you can, because it's going to be rezoned entertainment. That zoning would allow buildings of up to 20 stories, not just the stadium proposed here, that's just the start, but also future development, including shops, offices, hotels, apartments, nightclubs, and so on. I kid you not, that is the government's plan for Helen Mayo Park. The proposed stadium here would be just the beginning. Helen Mayo Park's got 257 trees, at least that's the City Council's tally. The official count includes 131 river red gums, 49 river she oaks, 14 sugar gums, 17 golden robinias, and quite a lot along the roadway here of Illawarra flame trees, which I wish were in bloom at the moment, but they're not. I wonder how many of those trees will be discarded one by one, development after development, as they progress, as Helen Mayo Park is converted bit by bit over coming years into entertainment zone. But back to the stadium, back to this site. The government's venue management corporation says the site is partly degraded or contaminated and partly behind a fence. That's true, it is. If you walked in from Montefiore Road, you would have seen that Helen Mayo Park's lost a slice to government employee parking just off the road behind the cyclone fence. It's lost another part to what is a fenced council works depot. You can see the workman's hut there. That's part of the park. And there's also this huge raised dirt area where Anne Moran's asked you not to be, you know, to be careful. That's soil that was dredged from the river almost a decade ago. It's contaminated, but nobody knows how badly. So the argument being mounted by the government and their cheerleaders amounts to this. You've lost some of Helen Mayo Park. We might as well take the rest. It's not a proper park. Let's confiscate it from you. An advertiser columnist very recently said the same thing with a headline, "Some parts of the parklands aren't worth saving." David Penberthy. Have these people not heard of the word reclamation or remediation or regreening or landscaping? You'd know, I hope, Rymal Park in the Eastern Parklands. Up until the 1950s, it had a big council rubbish dump. There are dozens of sites around the parklands that used to be rubbish dumps or industrial sites. Until 2012, there was an SA water depot that took out most of the western part of Park 25. That's now the Narnunga Urban Forest, one of the rare success stories in regreening. So degraded areas of the parklands, like this, can be reclaimed, but not if they're taken away with a $660 million 15,000 seat stadium. You've shown up, you're going to make history with us. But showing up today is just the beginning. We, all of us, have a big battle ahead. A battle against people who can smell a large pot of money. What a smell that is. But make history with us, save Helen Mayo Park. Take the time to contact not just the Planning SA website on your say, do that, but also make sure you tell any of the government MPs who did not turn up today and tell your friends about it. Thanks.
As we expect from a parkland crusader. Now I'd like to introduce another parkland crusader, Councillor Phillip Martin, an Adelaide City Councillor for the past 7 years, who has always been passionate about protecting the parklands from rapacious developers and who is ready to fight and stop this land grab. In my personal opinion, Councillor Martin is one of the bravest, most dedicated, dogged, and best spoken councillor we've ever had. And I'd just like to add, I know I'm the MC and I shouldn't be saying anything, but I'm so disappointed that the dominant faction of council that does control the decisions of council hasn't even bothered to send one member here. And I'm sure, I don't know what the Lord Mayor could possibly be busy at that's more important than coming to this. So I am disappointed and I apologise for our council. So Phillip Martin, would you come forward?
Thank you, and as some of you know, I haven't been well lately, but I've got to tell you, nothing sickens me more than what the state government has got planned for Park 27 and for our parklands. In fact, I am livid about it. The state is actually racing to gazette the changes to the parklands in this area by next month in the most disastrous fashion. Now, I have to say to you that the council of which I'm a member is quite sensitive to people like me making criticisms. So I make clear that these remarks are personal remarks alone, but I am sure that they are deeply shared by all of you. What is actually happening is there is a land grab going on. It's not just Park 27 here, in Helen Mayo Park. It extends right around us. We know, and there is no master plan, but we know from the information available that the state wants Helen Mayo Park. They want a place here, an entertainment precinct, which includes a stadium, but is not limited to a stadium, but which would allow buildings, commercial buildings, up to 20 stories. 20 stories here. They also want Kate Cox Park, which is also Park 27, not only for the Women's and Children's Hospital, but for a car park and other commercial buildings up to 15 stories. 20 stories, 15 stories. They've also declared they want Pinky Flat, just over the river. And that is such a significant part of the parklands, not only to all of us who are dedicated to the protection of the parklands, but to the Kaurna people. It is important to their history here in Adelaide. And finally, they want for a so-called innovation zone, a strip of parklands next to Botanic High running into the Botanical Gardens. This is a land grab like no other, and it is to be called out. Now, the City of Adelaide has considered this, and Shane made mention of the fact that it came to council last month and that we did formulate a position. That position, which was endorsed by the Lord Mayor, Sandy Verschoor, and her team at Adelaide, decided that we would put together a working group to collaborate with the state government, in the hope that we might get some concession from the state government. Now, my view is that talking to the state government on this, collaborating with the state government, is the wrong way to go. You simply say no. No. Now, let me tell you, I didn't vote for it, and some of my colleagues didn't vote for that either, but the majority Team Adelaide did. And the leader of Team Adelaide, who coincidentally is seeking to be a member of the Marshall government after the next election, if there is a Marshall government, he said that he thought the Lord Mayor was extending an olive branch to the state government, which is extraordinary, given that olive branches and olive trees are almost certainly going to be destroyed in this process. The Deputy Lord Mayor and member of Team Adelaide said, "Isn't it our job to be working collaboratively with the state government?"
No, it's not.
We are here by legislative mandate, according to the Parklands Act of 2005, to preserve these parklands for all South Australians. And it's about time the council did that. Another of the councillors who is a member of the Liberal Party, Aman Abrahim, today suggested that council should work collaboratively with the state government so we can have the least worst outcome. What is the least worst outcome? What we have to do, and I think everybody who's here today is demonstrating that, what we have to do is say to the Marshall land grab, no. We have to say to the City Council, no to collaboration. And we have to say to anyone who dares to lay their hands on these parklands, which are so vital to this city, we have to say no. And please join me, say it loudly, no.
Said Mr. Martin, Councillor Martin. Now, Speaker 3 is Robert Sims, MLC, who needs really no introduction, even though we haven't got an introduction for him here. Rob has been a councillor on the City Council and a very worthy one. He's also been a federal senator and he's now a member of the Upper House, State Upper House, and a ferocious protector of parklands, a ferocious Green member. And I could not speak any more highly of him and his performance on council, side by side, the very minority of councillors that support the parklands. As we always say, the words are good, but the actions are different, and Rob's actions have always been as a parkland protector. Thank you very much, Rob, and have Rob.
Thank thank you very much, and firstly, I really want to acknowledge the work of councillors Martin and Moran on the parklands. You know, these are two people that always stand up to protect our public space. They cop a lot of heat for doing it, and they always stand up against the majority in town hall and against vested interests to push for the public good. So thank you for your leadership. And can I say on this question of council's engagement with the government on this issue, it is not the role of the City Council to be the handmaiden of the government when it comes to development in the parklands. Now, I know some in town hall will say, oh, we need to have a seat at the table. Well, you know, we need to have a seat at the table. Well, no, actually what the council should be doing is turning the table over and saying to the government, no, we're not going to facilitate this land grab. And that's the outcome that the community should be demanding from their city council. So let's hold them to account for that. Can I say, in terms of where this sits within the parliament, the Greens are committed to fighting these changes tooth and nail. This proposal, if it gets through, is really, I think, a Trojan horse for the whole range of development opportunities that the state government has in its sights. It's talking about a sports stadium here for this park, but if that falls over, what else does it have in mind? It's trying to change the code to enable a whole range of development opportunities. Shops, cafes, restaurants, nightclubs, private residential development on the parklands. I mean, the idea that we could see private apartment towers, penthouses on the parklands is an absolute outrage. There has long been a principle advocated by parklands advocates and accepted by government that you don't have private residential development on public green space such as this. And so the idea that we would see a commercialisation of this space in that way and private residential properties, I think, is a really chilling outcome, particularly at this time of climate crisis.
Yeah.
So the Greens stand with you in this fight. We're going to do everything we can to defeat these changes when they come to the parliament. And we're going to do everything we can to ensure whoever is in government, whether it be the Liberal Party or the Labor Party, we're going to do everything we can to ensure that they actually protect our public green space. Now, when Parliament resumes in 2 weeks' time, I'm going to be moving a motion in the Legislative Council calling on the State Upper House to oppose the proposed sports facility for this site.
Yep.
And I really hope that the Labor Party get on board with that as well.
Yeah.
And we can use that to send the Marshall government a very clear message that this is going to have a very bumpy ride in the parliament.
Yep.
And if they want to take our city's green space, they are going to face one hell of a fight. Woo! Thanks, everybody.
Thank you, Rob. Well spoken. I'd now like to introduce speaker number four, who's Miss Lucy Hood. Lucy is a Labor candidate for the state seat of Adelaide. Lucy is a local and says this community has given her everything. It is where Lucy and her husband bought their first home, where she has worked all her career as a journalist and now as a policy writer, and where she is raising her two young children, Audrey and Ned. I'd like you to give a warm welcome to Mrs. Lucy Hood. Miss Lucy Hood.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Lucy Hood and I am Labor's candidate for the state seat of Adelaide. I'd also like to acknowledge that today we meet on the lands of the Kaurna people and pay our respects to elders past, present and emerging. I also look forward to a Malinowskis Labor government re-establishing the treaty process. I'd also like to thank our previous speakers. First of all, Shane, thank you so much for organising today's event. Also to Anne for emceeing, to Councillor Phillip Martin and the Honourable Robert Sims. He speaks very highly of his motion that he'll be putting forward to the Parliament, and I'm very excited today to say that a Malinowskis Labor team will support his motion.
Yay!
Now, I often speak fondly of my childhood growing up in the state's southeast. My older brothers and I would spend many hours climbing the old mulberry tree that was on our family's farm. We would eat all the berries and then climb down covered head to toe in purple mulberry stains. Now, we loved that tree so much that we named our family farm after that tree. And more than 100 years later, it still stands on our farm, Mulberry Farm, in Bullagoon. I came from a regional town, a community that values its natural and built heritage. You are all here today because you value our natural and built heritage. While as a child I played under the gums and the banksias of Crooked Lane in Bullagoon, my children play under the beautiful Moreton Bay fig tree at Marshmallow Park. While I used to play on the banks of the Narracourt Creek, my children play on the River Torrens and at Pinky Flat. Even though that I'm raising my children in the CBD, they are going to have the same magical memories of playing in nature because this is their backyard. So it begs the question, why is the Marshall Liberal government undertaking the largest land grab that we have ever seen? There is a reason that we are voted Australia's most livable city, and it's because of vistas like this. If the COVID-19 pandemic has taught us anything, it's that open green space is literally green gold. The Marshall Liberal government can't or is unwilling to even justify why we need this massive rezoning proposal. They couldn't even give their time today to join us here. They can't justify why they are rezoning Pinky Flat and Elder Park and even the River Torrens itself. And when we are in the middle of a health crisis where we're experiencing the largest record ramping that this state has ever seen, they think it's a priority to spend $662 million on a basketball stadium on this park. Building a hospital on the parklands is one thing, but undertaking rezoning to allow a basketball stadium, developments up to 20 stories, bars and nightclubs is a whole other ballgame. And let's look at the economics of this as well. Why is the Marshall Liberal government hell-bent on creating another city business district on the river when our CBD businesses are on their knees? Yeah. I was only speaking to a young small business owner last month who pre-pandemic had a thriving small business, but now he told me he can't believe he's contemplating insolvency in his early 30s. This massive rezoning bid is just a kick in the guts for small businesses like his and other CBD businesses. Time and time again, the Marshall Liberal government has shown it's got its priorities wrong. And when you compare their environmental credentials to that of the previous Labor government, there is a stark difference. We built the world's biggest battery. We made South Australia a renewable energy capital. The former Labor government under Jaya Weatherill invested $20 million in our parklands. And the former member for Adelaide, the formidable Jane Lomax-Smith, under the RAN Labor government, returned hectares of land to our parklands. I want to thank Jane for her advocacy and also for her guidance and support. And there is another female trailblazer that I want to mention today. The very lady that this park was named after. Now, Helen Mayo, as Shane was saying, didn't even know that female doctors existed, but she wanted to pursue a career in medicine. Now, her father was actually advised that Helen was too young to study medicine, but she persisted, and in 1898, she started studying medicine at the age of 20. She dedicated her career to advocating for the health and well-being of young mothers and their children. She stood up against the large institutions that were in the way of her dreams. She spoke up for the people whose voices were not necessarily the loudest. And now it is time for us to stand up and honour Helen Mayo. Now is the time for us to stand up for the people whose voices are not necessarily the loudest. That is our next generation, our children, our grandchildren, and our great-grandchildren, because they will inherit the consequences of the decisions that we make today. Our natural and built heritage is so important. It tells the stories of who we were, but how we value and protect that heritage speaks volumes about who we want to be. And I am proud to announce today that a Malinauskas Labor government will not build permanent structures on Helen Mayo. We will protect the trees and the beautiful walking and cycling paths. Nor will a Malinauskas Labor government build a $662 million basketball stadium, nor will we build permanent structures on Pinky Flat, on Elder Park, or on the River Torrens itself. Let's stand together and fight for these important community assets. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Lucy. What another wonderful speech. Now, I'm calling the next speaker, Jane O'Mac Smith, who really, it's almost insulting to have to introduce her, but because she's so well known and worthy of that fame. Jane O'Mac Smith is a pathologist who migrated to Adelaide over 40 years ago. She was immediately stunned by the heritage of the city and realised it was at risk. She has been at the forefront of campaigns to protect the parklands as a local resident, a city councillor, a Lord Mayor, MP and Cabinet Minister. And I would have to add that she was clearly the best Lord Mayor we'd have ever had, especially in those areas, and I wish she'd come back and save us.
Thank you, Anne, for those very generous comments. I also will acknowledge that we meet on Kaurna land, and there's a certain irony in that, because of course it is Kaurna land, it always has been and always will be, but it was one of the first areas that the colonists confiscated, stole, took. And over the 200 years that we have fought over this very land, the issues have not changed, because those colonial conquistadors almost wrote down that we should protect it and never sell our parklands, but save it for the good of the community. That was a good idea, but for 200 years, it has been honored almost in the breach, and we have fought tooth and nail over two centuries. If you go back through the history, it has been incremental nibbling and small attacks. I feel I've been around so long, I've seen it all before. I've seen all sorts of mad ideas, crazy development ideas, chances, and people wanting to grab little bits of the parklands. I've seen the planning department and the road widening gangs want to bite away at the edges. But when it comes to really wicked attacks on our parklands, it takes a government. Yay. And I've seen them all, and I'll be honest, Labor governments and Liberal governments have done the same thing over the years. They have all tried to look for cheap land. And I've heard stories of, wait for it, a temporary Commonwealth Games village. Really? I've seen the 200 metre long great grandstand for Clipsal, and wouldn't that be a white elephant now? I've seen no end of developments that governments have put up. And it's really been shocking to me. And I never thought that even I could be gobsmacked by the madness of a proposal. I never thought I could be so incandescent as I am now, because I am so shocked. This is not just a big plan for the biggest area I have ever seen being grabbed by a government. It doesn't just go from the Botanic Gardens to incorporate the jail. It doesn't just go to both sides of the river. It doesn't include Aboriginal burial sites, Pinky Flat, the land in front of the parade ground. It actually is, I was going to say audacious, but that almost sounds like a compliment. I meant audacious in the manner of, yes, Minister, it's a brave act.
Rapacious.
Because what in one stroke has happened is we have all realised how vulnerable the parklands are. Now, I have to say, I can't imagine what they're thinking. This is not a stadium. This is not even a hospital. It's not even a kiosk in the parklands. This is a massive land grab of 10% of our parklands. And it's not just apartment buildings. It's not even just hotels. They're talking about light industry. What are they thinking? Have they never been north of Jepps Cross and seen all that derelict industrial land? They're talking about a massive commercial activities. But the part that gives me the most pause to contemplate that maybe people haven't read the small print is that they're talking about land division.
Yeah.
Oh. Why do you need land division? Because you're selling something.
Yep.
You don't divide the parklands unless you're up to something truly dastardly.
Yep.
Now, what are they thinking? I wonder if the people in leadership positions think that this is a bit of riverbank, just like Brisbane or Melbourne. Don't they understand that this isn't rehabilitated industrial riverbank land? This is part of a massive parklands that was planned and designed 200 years ago. They've all travelled the world, and I love it when they say, oh, you know, they haven't got something like this in another country. We're a world-class city. We're world-class because we have some special amenities. It's not just a glass of wine and a bit of sunshine. It's the architectural design, the heritage buildings, and the ring of parklands. And what they're doing at a stroke is making it possible to destroy that ring of parklands. And I don't care if you go and see a politician, they say, oh, don't worry, we're not going to have a go at Pinky Flat. It would never happen. Once it's enshrined in the law, any chancellor and any developer can come up with a plan and have the right to put it there. They might not intend to do it this week, but once it's there, it's possible for others to do all sorts of things. The reason I find this is such a damaging proposal is that if you could imagine you were flying over the parklands and you look down, you would see that figure of eight.
Yes.
It's a unique design for a parklands with a city in a park. And that unique design is part of the National Heritage listing. It is the potential part that will allow us to get World Heritage listing. It is iconic. It is unique. It is special. And if you think in Berlin, Paris, New York, Rome, London, they wouldn't build on Regent's Park. They wouldn't. But their park doesn't have such an interesting historical design and configuration as ours. Ours is world class and should be World Heritage listed. So what are they thinking? Far be it from me to put myself in the minds of our illustrious leaders, but it has been put to me that this is just an ambit claim. Don't worry, they'll backtrack on Pinky Flat, and then we'll all be happy because we're a bit dim-witted. The reality is that if that's the plan, then it sounds like a third-rate plot out of Yes Minister. I don't know if that's the plan. I've also been told it's not a plan that's just to take the parklands, it's an economic issue.
Yeah.
And maybe Treasury does have a grand plan. They've usually got a grand plan to save money. Maybe they do want to sell the land to build houses. Maybe they do want to get at the old children's hospital and sell it for apartments. Maybe it's financial to dig us out of the hole after COVID. I can't imagine what they're thinking, but I know what I want to tell them. Because I think there's something really ominous about this assault on our expectations. And when I say expectations, I think our leaders govern because there's a social license. We vote for them, we give them the right, we expect them to do the right thing. And at the core of this, it isn't even about party politics. I mean, it's great to have Greens and Labour Party members here, but this issue strikes at the heart of trust. It's about ethics.
It's
about morals. And I have to say, it's about a trust in a fair process. I must say this process doesn't give me faith. I lack trust. I'm concerned that our public institutions will be used not just for a nefarious purpose, but you have to say, if you read these documents, it doesn't explain that the land they are taking is not some post-industrial wasteland. It doesn't give full due credit to the fact this is our iconic National Heritage Listed Parklands. There are a lot of words about connections, you know. You've got connections through the oval. You can walk from one side to the other. It doesn't mean it's a public space. It's a privatised space. You cannot walk through parkland and enjoy it if you're actually inside a building. And I think when community members begin to see arbitrary decision-making, high-handedness, a lack of consistency and respect for our legislation, which after all, the latest round's only been in since 2005, and it said very clearly, and this is where this silly idea of collaborating with the government comes from, it does say that this is to be managed for the protection and enhancement of the area, and it's a space for the benefit of the people of South Australia to be available for their use and enjoyment. That has been forgotten. This is being treated purely as a development site. And what I fear is that when we see publicly owned and loved parklands taken away from us, we not only lose faith in democracy and our institutions, we begin to believe in conspiracy theories, fringe groups, and a whole range of sort of populist anarchic ideas, because the system is not working. There is no consistency and one begins to lose faith. But having said that, we need to make sure that the government hears our voice, And there are many things we could do. The first thing, and I think this is really important, is to make sure that everybody you know understands this. I'm extremely boring. I go to the hairdresser, I go to the deli, I go in a queue to catch a bus, and I harangue anyone I can find and tell them about this. Do that. Tell your friends, because many people, surprisingly enough, don't read the Advertiser. They haven't seen the front page. They don't know what's going on. They think it's just a stadium, just a hospital. The magnitude of this needs to be spelled out and people need to understand how wide and big and dangerous this is. So spread the word. The next thing is go onto the website, and you don't have to be much of a Google warrior to find it. It's Your Say Riverbank Precinct and you'll find it very easily. They'll give you a quick poll site, they'll allow a comment, and they'll allow a submission. Do all of those things. The next thing I would really recommend is that you make an appointment to go and see your local MP. And one of the things I feel very strongly about is this isn't just for the seat of Adelaide. This is an iconic site and an important piece of parklands for every South Australian. And it is maintained partially by the government and the state city council, because it's a site that belongs to all. The government would not support or be interested in the parklands if it weren't seen as of national significance. And you need to make sure wherever you live, not just in Unley, not just in Adelaide, not just in Norwood, wherever you are, make an appointment and go and see your local MP and tell them how strongly you feel about this. I would also recommend that, having done that, if you live in the city council area, you make sure that our city councillors know, and the ruling faction, the Lord Mayor's team, they need to understand that their role is not to be a helper, a facilitator, and a kindly support team for the state government, but to stand up and argue. Their constituency is not the same as the state government's. They are not beholden to development, and they are not required to work always by just rolling over with whatever the government wants. They can talk, they can collaborate, but they don't have to agree with them all the time. And if they need any reminders, of course it's an election year. There are a lot of elections coming up, and you need to make sure that you remember what you've heard and what's been said to you. So go to the deli, go to the bus stop, go to the hairdresser, send out the messages by email and get everyone to respond. Because this is actually enraging. It is outrageous. It is beyond anything I have ever seen before, and it needs to be stopped, because above all, it is immoral.
Thank you very
very much to the speakers. Now that will end the speeches and the formal parts. I urge you to speak to any of the speakers that you would like to clarify some of their statements or ask what you can do further. I'll now reintroduce the band, the Serotonins. The band will play till 2 p.m. There is no need to clear the area immediately after that, so stay longer if you like. You might wish to ask questions privately, as I said, of any speakers. And also pick up rubbish, of course. I don't need to say that. Thank you very much for attending, and I want to again thank the speakers who gave a magnificent outline of the problems we seek to fix. Thank you.